We are heading on to another interesting session of today, which is based on robotic automation in fintech world. And we have other speaker, Mr. Satish Kumar Dwibhashi, with us. And I request Corey sir, the vice chairman of Bangalore branch, to please accompany the speaker to the dais and welcome him with a floral bouquet. Please give a big round of applause for this speaker. Welcome, Mr. Satish Kumar. Thank you, Corey, sir. A brief, quick profile of the today's speaker. Mr. Satish Kumar has 20 years of experience in IT, and he was a senior vice president and CISO at Wipro in Bangalore. It's a California company which is a leading provider of payment security and mobile payments in emerging markets with a strong market presence in India, one of the world's leading digital payment markets. Prior to this, he was in IBM India as a compliance lead, information security and risk management. He is also certified CISA, CISM, CRISC, CBCI, ISO 2001, lead auditor and implementer, COVID-5 Foundation and implementation, an active platinum member of ISACA, and enjoys teaching and mentoring. He has been actively volunteering for more than a decade and is currently a president and CSX license at ISACA Bangalore chapter. He is a regular speaker at various events and forums and provides a thought leadership. So we are eager to hear from you on robotic processes. Welcome, sir, and just hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So good afternoon, all of you. Hello. Good afternoon. Very good afternoon. Post-lunch effect. Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizers and especially CA Shivram Bhatt, in fact, for inviting me here. In fact, it's a pleasure always. I have a great respect and affinity for Shivram, because he was my colleague, in the previous company, or in his previous company, my current company where I work, that is Wipro. He was the CFO, and of course, I still continue there as the CISO. So once again, thanks, Shivram, for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts to the larger community. So I'll just start slowly. Again, the topic is very interesting. I should say the current trend, In fact, I'm sure many of you heard of these buzzwords, AI, ML. Of course, every conference you go, no conference ends up without talking artificial intelligence, machine learning, and of course, one of the other is also robotic process automation, which is a very, very current, So while, of course, Shivram wanted me to talk, basically topic is more around fintech, I'll just make it more holistic, because RPA is used in all of the domains today. So before I go jump into RPA, rather I want to start basic from automation. I'm sure all of you understand and or it's today automation is inevitable. So I also want your participation. Let's make it more interactive rather than, I don't want to make it I hope you heard of this term called PPT by death, right? So I don't want to run through so many slides. So I just want to talk more from my heart and what I do and how we use automation and how you also, in fact, honestly, many of you already, especially the finance professionals, of course, CAs are very close to my heart. I've worked very closely with them. So all of you use Excel? Yes or no? Of course. And I'm sure many of you use Excel macros? Yes or no? So in fact, Excel macros is also automation, right? So sometime, of course, all these new buzzwords, but then automation has been there for ages. Honestly, all have been doing automation for your clients or for whatever. So any repeated task, what mundane tasks we want to automate. In fact, that bigger version is what RPA, of course, for the larger enterprises where there are different challenges. So we'll discuss that, of course, but then automation is a very old topic. It's not that I'm talking something new, but yes, especially, so two important things. One is we are talking software robots. I'm not here to talk about, I think I was looking at the agenda. There was a previous topic on Industry 4.0. I think that gentleman would have spoken about robots. I'm talking about the physical robots today, how they are used in industries, especially. So that's all about the physical robots. But my topic is more on the, while the topic may look like robot, but then we're talking about software. It's a pure software robot or a robotic process, basically, to see how we can automate mundane tasks. So that's the context. So again, I come from this company called Vibmo. I'll talk about my experiences. We also do a lot of automation because especially we are a service provider for many banks. Now I'm sure all of you who do a lot of banking with leading banks today, banks use a lot of automation, especially for fraud detection. I'm sure all of you know today, many of you use, if you look at your card transaction, in fact, while the card unions, Visa, MasterCard, JCB, MX, they definitely use a lot of automation. In fact, we ourselves also, we provide a lot of solutions. In fact, most of solutions are like risk-based authentication, that today fraud detection, these are all very fundamental today. And probably without RPAs, without automation, without technology, probably these things cannot be achieved. So I'll make it more interesting. But I thought, let me first start with the latest fintech trends. I think let me spend some time here. I'm sure many of you heard of all these things, but so I thought before jumping to RPA, let me spend some time on these typical trends. Rather, let me take a small pause and talk about the disruptions happening in this industry. Of course, while I'll talk fintech, but every industry, there's no industry today where the digital disruption is not happening. Do you all agree? Is there any industry who says that no, we do not want to engage into some digital transformation? So I think today, digital transformation has become a buzzword. In fact, I think in many forums you listen to this digital transformation, digital disruption, because of the changing customer needs. Of course, we as a customers also, right? We want everything to happen, something very similar like a Uber way. I call it as Uber way. Even in the bank, right? The bank through which you bank, I don't think today bank, you want the same Uber experience in the banking also, right? You want an app where things should happen on the right, on the click of button. So one side is digital transformation, digital disruption, absolutely on the rise, and it is going to really continue, or absolutely it's inevitable, because innovation happens through disruption, and disruption, especially digital disruption, is the key. So in that context, if you look at all those, these are the key trends. Of course, predominantly the fintech, blockchain, I'm sure many, let me go just one by one quickly, let me spend some time, it's worth spending some time. So blockchain, I'm sure all of you heard of this blockchain, it's a very known term today. While people relate blockchain with cryptocurrencies, of course, blockchain is the technology behind the crypto, but then blockchain as a technology today, many organizations are embarking into the blockchain journey, even the banks. ICICI is the first bank to adopt blockchain as a technology. There's an open banking consortium has been formed, and a lot of things are happening in that space. So second one, artificial intelligence. I'm sure this is, again, a very common term, AI, ML, right? Artificial intelligence and machine learning go synonymously. We'll discuss more how AI, ML also is playing a very important role along with RPA. So RPA is, of course, the process automation part, but again, adding AI, the artificial intelligence, into the RPA gives you more cognitive capabilities to predict. Today, it's all about predictive analysis, predictions. Of course, you must have heard of IBM Watson platform today. Watson, right? I'm sure you heard of Watson playing chess, right? I'm sorry. IBM playing, Watson playing chess against the, the Grandmaster and how all that you must have heard. So Watson is again an AI engine, I should say. Voice technology, I'm sure many of you have seen today, your voice has become the password. In fact, many IVR systems today, when I log into, when I call the Standard Chartered Bank, so it says, can you just, so my voice becomes my password. So definitely voice biometrics is gaining momentum. I'm sure many of your mobile phones has this thumb and your thumb scanners through which it can authenticate. So regulation technology, it's more about the increased regulations. Of course, the number 5 is what is our discussion. I'll expand that. Robotic process automation. IoT, I'm sure many of you heard. Number 6, Internet of Things. Today, the world is getting connected. Everything is getting connected. I'm sure most of you Apple users, you talk to Siri or your Alexa, right? Especially keep talking to Alexa. Alexa listens to you, answers you. These are all internet, IoT based connected devices today. I think today we are living in a connected world today. In fact, as we can see a lot of more adoption of IoTs. I'm sure you heard of smart cities. So smart cities and everything is going to be connected. So Internet of Things is also one of the key trend, especially we are seeing. Number 7, I think I can talk one full day about the cloud. I don't want to dilute the discussion. So cloud, I'm sure you know cloud is one of the key trend today. So there are many companies which are cloud first companies who are only on cloud. I'm sure many of you heard Redbus. Redbus is purely on cloud. Or of course your whole Amazons and many other. So which are purely the cloud adoption is on the rise. I'm not saying only public cloud. Of course banks, they use private clouds because they are a little skeptical on the data being, of course, always there's a question, right? When it's cloud, the cloud security becomes one of the key aspect, but then yes, private cloud solves that issue because private cloud is like you building your own cloud, like my organization, we have our own private cloud. In fact, we have a very robust infrastructure which runs in my own data center, my own environment. We have complete control on that. So it's as good as a private cloud. Something very similar to public cloud, but purely in my own environment. The payment services directive, of course, so the lot of payment regulations, I'm sure today we all know, right? India being the payments hub, if you ask me, digital payments, especially, I think many of you have started reading, right? UPI becoming global, yes or no? UPI, I think it's one of the great example how payments have been made so simple, right, through UPI. Now probably UPI will be hitting the global industry, global market also. It's a great achievement that we have done. NPCI, of course, together with RBI, IDRBTI, they've done a great job. So the lot of payment, payment innovations happening. Again, coming back to the fintech. So fintech is a very active domain today. Lot of disruption, lot of innovation happening in that space. So that's where I also love to be in that. So my company being a fintech disruptor, so I love to be there, but of course, I know my role is different, little challenging because of security, right? So we are always targeted, and again, that's the lighter side. It keeps my job is always at stake, having sleepless night. So again, number 9, IPO, I'll not talk much because that's a lot of fintech. Number 10, biometric, and 11, simplifying procedures. Again, this goes back to RPA, how we can simplify things today by automation. And then, of course, the last one, digital banking. Today, we're talking about digital banks. So I'm sure you heard of, like example, DBS, especially. It's all app-based banking, right? You don't need to go to the branch completely. It's a mobile-based, app-based banking. So these are the some of the disruptions, especially the fintech trends, what we're seeing. The key trend, of course, my discussion today is RPA. So I'll just focus more on robotic process automation, RPA. So what exactly is RPA? So while as the term, let's break it down, RPA. So we all understand process and we all understand automation. So it's all about, basically it's all, so if you look at RPA, it's all about creating some certain software processes where we can automate things, especially those, I should say, tedious tasks, or I should say repetitive tasks, repetitive, which are in nature, which you keep repeating day in, day out. So I think, let me just give a pause here. Most of time, there are a lot of other thought process. People say that RPA, right? RPA is great, but will RPA, if RPA takes over completely, will people lose jobs? That's one of the biggest concerns what people may have. But having said that, if you see, I think today our nations are talking about efficiencies, are talking about providing experiences to the clients, customers, right? So I think the human people should be put to the right use, right? Means, of course, no, none of us will like to do a job which is very repetitive, right? Every day morning you come, 9 to 5, you do the same job again and again, probably mundane, right? Which is not a human is for, right? Of course, human has got brain, he can really do much better things. So in that context, a lot of these tasks which are very, very repetitive, which are very mundane, in fact, which probably by automating these tasks, so your people's time is freed, yes or no? The people's time, when I say human times, are used for a better productive things, which probably because human can think beyond computers and differently. So that's the purpose. It's not that RPA, so many organizations do not use RPA just for cost cutting. I keep doing these sessions, I do a lot of debates on. So RPA is not just a cost-cutting exercise. In fact, many organizations take RPA initiative to increase value. I should say increase sales, increase turnover, increase top line, increase your revenue, or typically, let me tell, providing experience to the customers is what RPA is all about. Of course, I'll expand that in much better way, but then, so RPA okay, predominantly people talk about tools. I'll talk about tools, but then initially it's all about automation. It's all about making your processes efficient. Let me again give a pause here. Again, RPA is again not new, because let me start, go back to little 10 years back history. RPA is not new. In fact, while it's become buzzword today, of course, because with the increased pressure, global pressure from the industries to be more efficient. But then let's go back to, I think all of you are finance professionals, typically you all understand ERP. Let's go back to our ERP days. Because I started my journey, in fact, I come from that domain. In fact, I was instrumental in picking up and deploying ERP, SAP in Sterlite Industries. I was the IT head for Sterlite. In fact, pre-ERP days were MRP, Material Resource Planning. I'm sure many of you heard of, or differently you know, traditional manufacturing organizations were focused on those MRP, material resources and planning. So MRP, MRP2, then the evolution went into ERP. So what exactly ERP is? So can I ask you a simple question? Why organizations went into ERP? Why many enterprises embarked into the ERP journey? It's not about just digitization, it's not just about computerization, but it's about how do they increase their efficiencies, productivity. Just an example, if Bajaj, my favorite example, go back to the old days of Bajaj, where Rahul Bajaj was very, right, he was the man behind the scooters. And after lately, when Rajiv came into the Bajaj, I'm sure you know Rajiv, son of Rahul, who in fact came with a lot of innovation, thought process, of course the young. So he said, Dad, if we continue making the same, in the same way the scooters, right, people will not buy, because by the time industry opened up, Suzuki's, Honda's, Kawasaki's started coming into the enterprises, into the world. So that's where Raju said that we need to innovate, we need to be different, and because the consumer choice is not scooter, it's motorcycle. But then I think that's the point where Raju took it very seriously. He made a complete automated plant in Pune, Chakan. And I'm sure many of you know the outcome was Pulsar. I'm sure you all know. Today, if I remove Pulsar, there is no Bajaj, yes or no? So Bajaj is all about Pulsar. And why I went back, because that's where, so the first thing what Raju, when he came into the organization, he said that, because they were using a very old monolithic COBOL-based solution, managing inventory, finance, accounts, all that, which was probably not what can take Bajaj to the next level. That's where, I think the point what I'm trying to make is, your processes, as you become very old, your processes become inefficient. I'm sure many of you heard of something very interesting, because that's my, again, very close to my heart, is BPR, Business Process Reengineering. I'm sure many of you heard of this term. So why I'm going back to this, because these are all essential components in an automation journey, because you simply cannot automate a very inefficient thing and try to just add a computer. It's not that computers will make magic, because if your processes are inefficient, so you're just digitizing the inefficient process. So many organizations who embarked into the journey of ERP, okay, it need not be only SAP, it can be Oracle, BAN, PeopleSoft, JD Edwards. Today, Microsoft has got multiple ERPs like Exapta, Navision, Great Plains, and there are many more. Of course, even your Tally, I think many of your people use Tally. Tally is also a great ERP. Of course, small, mid-size organizations use Tally. So before you get into an ERP journey, many organizations do an BPR, Business Process Reengineering. Why I'm putting this? Because, so these are all were there since ages. So in fact, a decade back, organizations started doing this. In fact, go back to the Bajaj was just an example. Even Mahindra and Mahindra, the tractor companies, they also, when they embarked into the SAP journey, in fact, they also went through this BPR process of how do they re-engineer the processes? Because process efficiencies will only come once you understand the process, make certain changes, and then automation makes sense. So that's the background history of process automation. It has been there for ages. Of course, today, organizations have taken this journey a little forward. I'm sure you know, today, every manufacturing organization runs on pure automation. Today, if you look at my favorite example, I keep telling, example, Ford Motors, the car company, completely runs on SAP. Because I talk cybersecurity also. So if SAP is down, literally Ford factory will be down, because the tighter integration between the factory, it's all completely tightly integrated with process control systems. That's again where IoTs, your SCADA systems all come in play. So the lot of automation has already been done. Of course, today these robots also are used in most of the places where you require those automation. So automation has been there for ages, but then we're talking about the next, in fact, I should say the next layer of automation is more about how do we make this repeated tasks more, easy, faster, so that people can focus, they can, basically the time is freed up so that they can spend more time on other better things where a human is required. So that's the whole background. So typically, what is RPA? So I'm sure you can read for yourself, but then, so automation that interacts with the computer-centric process. Please understand, I told you, that's where I want to set the context. I'm not talking about hardware robots or physical robots with hands and legs and all. That's already industry 4.0. Industry 5.0 talks about how robots, human can work together, because robots and human work together today in factories, because some process a physical robot does, some, or rather a people also today work together with robots, especially think of a factory furnace where a human, right? It's always a human danger if we enter the, so that's where robots are sent. And there are a lot of, so working together is industry 5.0. And my focus of RPA is more software centric. So basically robotic process automation, when we say robotic, it's basically, it's a software, it's a piece. So humans who create this process automation by creating workflows. It's pretty simple. It's like you create a workflow, what needs to be done first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and you just set the sequence, the workflow, and the robotic process ensures that that is done all the time, all the time, all the time, all the time, without missing any step. And because humans work 9 to 5, but this process will run 24/7. There's no fatigue. People will have fatigue, right? People after 8 hours, they may miss step two, they may miss step three, they may go to step four, but computer process, a software process, which is designed by a programmer or a software design, once you've set the workflow, it will continue doing, it will keep on doing the way it has been software defined. So it's all about the programming, the programmed. Of course, we'll talk about the tools today. It's not that you need to learn programming. The tools are much intuitive, graphical based. You can drag and drop, like it's like paintbrush. You just take tools, something similar today. RPA tools have made it easy for you to automate those RPA automation journey. We'll get there. But so typically I told you the right side, RPA aims to replace repeated tasks performed by humans with a virtual workforce. So typically it's like virtual workforce, this processes are, it runs on and on. So humans then make judgmental calls, handle exceptions. There will be exceptions, of course. That's where humans are required. It's not that computers or RPAs can take over completely. And of course, people provide oversight. When I say oversight, governance, all that is differently required. So RPA, so it's all about automation and it's all about predefined tasks. So robotic automation uses a computer, that is typically what we call robot, is just a software process to run application software in the exact same way that a person works with that software. So let me take because I just don't want to talk only about slides, but then let's take example today in the because the industry where I work, it is humanly not possible. Imagine in a transaction control system, imagine the banks. I think you can see the volumes today, right? Let's talk about credit card transactions. Now see the number of transactions the banks today process, right? Of course, you look at a bank like a large bank. So many transactions are being processed. Now, is it humanly possible to see every transaction, make a judgment that which transaction is fraud, which transaction is legitimate? It is humanly not possible. It's not. I'm sure many of you, all of you, use credit cards, and definitely all of you would have faced an instance where your credit card, normally the credit card systems of the banks, they are very intelligent. They are programmed such a way that they understand, the program understands the pattern in which you use the credit card. Means, imagine your credit card, typically your common spending pattern, where do you shop, what is shopping, I think that's what the programs will create a baseline. There's a lot of data, that's what is big data, data science. So lot of data, the bank, when I say bank, the bank systems understand your spending pattern, where do you live. You understand, today thanks to mobile telemetry, right, they know where do you live, where do you go. Thanks to Google, so a lot of data banks have about you, and I think thanks to that data which helps you. So normally your credit card is swiped in standard food world, big bazaar, standard, your shopping pattern is 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 rupees, genuine transactions. While of course India RBI has made a mandate of two-factor authentication, but still there are places where that extra factor, right, probably may not be a mandate. Of course, in e-commerce transaction, it's a mandate, but then still, suddenly your card is swiped in a jewelry shop for a high-value transaction. I'm sure many of you would have got a phone call, yes or no? You quickly get a phone call. I think before you leave that counter itself, you get a phone call confirming the transaction done by you. It can be an IVR call, automated call. It can be a physical call. Again, no, please understand, it all depends on the risk of the transaction. Not necessarily every time you may get a call, but the moment the system understands this transition looks to be little risky transition, high value transition. Or imagine morning you are in Chennai and suddenly your card has been swiped in, say, Pakistan, right? Second half probably, or there's a doubt. So I think whenever the systems has, so these are all risk-based systems. Why I just went there? Because this is where the whole automation, the RPA processes are used, because it's humanly not possible for people to monitor every transaction. You cannot expect that people, of course, there is a, so these systems will automatically, in fact, each of your transaction is code, because I work in that domain, it's called risk score. So every transaction you do, the system checks, is this transaction risky, not risky, risky, not risky, you understand? So the moment a transaction looks to be a risky, so actually that's what we call the authentication is stepped up. When I say step up authentication, so then people normally argue with me that when I use this, my same card in US or some other parts of the world, there is no extra authentication, because those countries, by default, every transaction goes through risk-based authentication. So there, of course, India, RBI, because of the volume what we have, here every transaction, even if you do a 50 rupees transaction, it asks OTP, right, or the PIN. But in some countries that is not there, but then in that countries also the authentication steps up based on the risk. So why I took this example, this is a classic example how in the fintech space today, I know, I think many of you say that, yeah, there are too many frauds today. Yes, of course, but still, see the volume, the scale and size in which the fintech operates, the number of UPI transactions, you know, right? Google Pay and Phone Pay, the volumes have become so high, so it is humanly not possible for someone to sit and analyze transactions and stop these frauds. So most of the card management systems and the fraud management systems, RPA, has been there for ages, if you ask me. Of course, that's now getting more and more because of the data science, because of the big data. I think the more data you have, the systems can predict, because the point is system knows, now where are you? System knows what transition you normally do, and systems knows. So I think that's the point, the power of data. I'm sure we all, I think you would have heard many times, data is the new oil. So data, data, data. So this data is churned and is used for automating. And this is one of the classic use case, especially the card unions, these companies, banks use. In fact, every bank uses this fraud engines, which is inevitable today because of the increased frauds. So this is again one of the classic example of RPA. So now, again, I'm just trying to balance between slides as well as, of course, talk about my experiences. Otherwise, it should not be very boring. So now let me just move to my other slide, which is, I know you cannot see each one of them, but then the trends, basically how RPA, in fact, how today the industry adoption, if you look at the adoption, in fact, these are all more statistics about how today, in fact, how automation, in fact, this is a Forrester survey research report, means how today, what you call the industry is adopting, if you look at the percentages, in fact, in 2019 and beyond, many organizations are really going to use more and more RPA to automate, right? So automation is the key, and this is basically more about the current adoption rate and of course the future adoption. So you can see the second one, say the, imagine, so in manufacturing, in IT, in financial industries, so RPA adoption is going to increase, and it will increase because the benefits what industries have started seeing, because I told you it's not only about cost control, it's about giving that user experience, providing that, especially the example what I took, there's no other way you can curtail frauds, because frauds are continue to happen, but then the more data you have, the more you do prediction. I think that's the adoptions today. In every enterprises today, we're seeing lot of, in fact, impact in these industries. And also, if you look at the below, the RPA skill set jobs also, in fact, are also increasing. So it's a big demand as a skill set. At the end, I know many of you, if you want to enter into the RPA journey, I'll show you some websites where you can easily learn RPA. There's a lot of free trainings available. Of course, I'm just making it high level, but then at the end, I'll talk about the lot of RPA tools and a lot of communities today available who provides a lot of training. We'll discuss that. So this slide basically talks about the current adoption and how the adoption is going to increase year by year, and absolutely companies are taking this into the mainstream. So across industries, if you see, especially banking, finance and accounting industries have really taken this high adoption, if you see. So that bold is all about high adoption. Already, in fact, globally, in the banking industries, think of a small example, the moment you open a bank account, you understand? The moment you open a bank account, what all happens? In the back end, the bank has to give you a account number, right? And then they have to provision you in the banking systems. They have to provide you the e-banking username, password. They have to issue a debit card, your PIN. You know, there's a whole set of things happens in the back end. Now, these set of things happens in a sequence. Now, these are mundane tasks. Now, in this whole sequence of tasks, if one task is missed, you got the debit card, but PIN is not coming, or you got the password, but then user is not yet created in the backend system, because people are people. People may miss some process. So you can imagine all of this process can be automated. So means what? In the backend, the moment you open a bank account, in the backend, a robotic process kicks in, and because they're just waiting, the robotic process is waiting for you to So the moment the system says that yes, account is open, that's it. In the backend, it will just keep, it will just do it quickly. Means probably to create a bank, just example, a customer opens a bank, for you to start banking, probably earlier, global banks used to take average 3 to 5 days. Today, the whole process happens in 20 minutes flat. Means probably in 15 minutes flat, you, the moment you open an account, you are just ready to go. That's the expectation customers are expecting. I told you, again, not we all, but especially the young generation who are going to come into the, I'm sure you all know, right? Think of your children, the Gen Ys, Gen Zs, what I call millennials, are restless, right? They are all WhatsApp guys, right? They want everything to happen on WhatsApp. So they are used to instant things, order food by Swiggy. They want to order and food should be ready. So they want, they say, I open account, the next minute I should be able to use the account. That's it. Why should I wait for the bank to send me? I think that is the demand, what the customers are demanding, and these processes are helping not only banks, of course banks, because my discussion is more around fintech or banking. So banks, you can see, banking is the only, the banks and finance is the biggest domain which have really taken RPA to the mainstream, and they have really adopted to the fullest. If you see the globally, of course, even Indian banks, there's a classic case study of, I'll show you if time permits at the end, depending how I do. So there are, I'll show you some websites, some good case studies where, like example, our own banks, our own Indian banks, in the website, I'll show you, like example, Federal Bank or many banks, how did they use RPA to provide better customer experience. So these are classic examples, classic use cases where automation is the only way to give the seamless services on a fast, and these are mundane tasks. Do you agree? These are repeated tasks. You cannot, you don't want to put 10 people and just ask them to do the same thing again and again. People are people. People don't like to do the same thing again. They want to do something different. So that's where the whole point about, and of course, I'm sure many of you today have seen, to go to any website today, you see a lot of chatbots, yes or no? Chatbots are all, actually chatbots are classic example of RPA. Everywhere you go, but it, I'm not saying it's only the chatbot can do everything for you. So it's basically, I told you, it's a together. The chatbot does most of things and finally hands out to a person, say that now beyond this discussion, the person should take it, but otherwise today, I think many of you seen most of the websites today have these chatbots which are very, very intelligent. Again, that's also one of the classic example of RPA automation. So banking, insurance, you can see manufacturing, no doubt, is again one of the key, because a lot of repetitive tasks happens in manufacturing. So I'm not saying RPA probably is there for every, in every industry, but then most of the industries which has got this set of repetitive tasks, their RPA really adds a lot of value. And I don't see, they only talk about cutting cost, but then they see how they can increase value, because today it's all about creating value to the stakeholders. That's the key point. So RPA adoption across processes and industries is on the rise, no doubt about that. I can just, I know you cannot see it, but then you can see the banking domain, the card activation, I told you, card activation, fraud detection, all these are the industry which the processes, especially I told you, fraud discovery is a classic story, classic example. RPA is doing great wonders because it has data, it can predict. Means RPA plus AI, artificial intelligence, together really powers the systems to predict. Because the moment you're traveling, it knows that now the next swipe may be in the city where you have just landed, because it understands. Because it understands, probably today many banks also want you to declare that you are on international travel. It knows you can enable your card to international spending. So they have data and it can predict based on your spending pattern, based on the risk level, based on the telemetry data, based on location, based on 140 parameters today. In fact, every transaction what you do, the banking system gets 140 parameters data, means from which location, which site, which city, including what device are you using. Are you using a mobile device? Are you on Apple or an Android? Is it a jailbroken device? Is your device compromised? It has got so much data. And based on the data, it can predict that is this a legitimate transition or it is a risky transition, and it can challenge you by asking more questions to make it tougher for the fraudster not to make transactions. But anyway, we'll not talk about the, but the point is about the, the fraud systems and all, RPA, in fact, to discover frauds, RPA has been there and it's really increasing. All the card networks, Visa, MasterCard, all of them use extensively RPA because that's the only way they can, because it's humanly not possible for them, because they churn, they do a lot of processing of transaction. So typically, again, I know it's hard to see. Typically, I told you RPA is all about the flow of steps of the process. Step one, step two, step three, step four, step five, what happens? So typically the RPA, so the point is, I told you, where does RPA adds value, right? The point, so there are many, many processes in an organization. So I think typically as a part of consulting arrangement, most of the engagement starts with which processes need to be automated. So that's where I think you can go and do the a typical process map, process flow, which are the typical steps which are mundane, means the things are, it will remain same. There is no change in the process. Step one, step two, step three, step four, step five. And I think, so a process analysis is mostly done. And then, so which process can be automated? So I think where we can get the maximum value. Of course, some processes probably you cannot automate. You leave that process because normally any RPA journey in any enterprise starts with a business case. Because of course, you will go into the journey. One is, of course, understanding the organization objectives. What is that I want to achieve through RPA journey? And then what is my outcome? So I think many organizations starts with the journey of doing a process mapping, process analysis, which processes, and also the pain points, right? Of course, there are certain pain points. Every organization, I told you the Bajaj story. Bajaj had a pain point because they were less automated. There was no R&D. There was no technology. Typical Bajaj Chetak scooter, right? Manufacturing company with a lot of workforce. So Rajiv said that this is not what I wanted to do. So I think that's where he understood what are the pain points, where I can use automation, where I can use technology, where I can I use all this. I think that's where he went into the journey. I think that's the outcome today, what we see, a technology advanced bike like Pulsar coming out of our own Indian Bajaj. Of course, Mahindra's example, like Scorpios and Bolero, it's a great product examples after technology adoption. And so I think today, all these enterprises have too many processes. One, of course, no doubt, processes may be inefficient, but second is automation helps them to achieve greater process efficiencies through this automation. So I don't want to use the word computerization. That's been there for ages. You all know you are typically a financial accounting, inventory, payroll, all those are anyway digitized. But then we're talking here, how can I make repeated tasks automated by just creating certain process automation scripts? It's I told you, it's something similar to, means to take an analogy for your example, like you, the Excel, right? Every day, I think when you file a return or you're calculating GST or you're taking some, your accounts receivable, accounts payable, doing reconciliation, I think I can just relate to your own daily tasks, probably what you keep on doing repeatedly, right? I think I know many young CAs, many, because I also know a lot of guys especially do a lot of Excel automation. Yes or no? How many of you are here who do a lot of Excel automation? Few, right? Few would love to, of course, I'm not saying it's a rocket science or you need to be a programmer. Of course, it's simple. You can just go and learn Excel. There are a lot of Excel tips and tricks where you can create macros, right? So creating a macro and just running a macro is as good as just automation. That's how it starts. A small automation starts from there, and then it, so this small automation, what you do in Excel, the same thing for large enterprises. Imagine your, all these big enterprises, they want their processes to be efficient, automated. That's the journey. So typically this is the industry-wide scope. If you look at HR, okay, HR is a classic example. HR, imagine a large call center, BPO, very, very big organization where people just come, people come and go, come and go. When I say come and go, there's a lot of workforce movement, right? People just join, people leave, join, especially BPO call center. The biggest challenge for HR is to how do they onboard, yes or no, onboarding, right? Getting people into the organization and enabling access to them, providing all the way what to make the employee productive. They have to do a lot of repeated tasks. Now, a lot of places in HR, right? The payroll, all these places, RPA makes a lot of great, in fact, many large enterprises, you can see this HR, supply chain, finance, accounting is one big area. In fact, if you ask me, the biggest adoption of RPA is in finance and accounting domain. Especially think of all your standard regular reconciliations or what example you need to go back and read 1,000 invoices, pick up some data, put that data in the Excel file. From there, I need to take data to some other file. Your whole GL processing, all that. In fact, if you go back to every ERP solution, especially SAP and all the solutions, use a lot of automation, process automation, and that can be also made more efficient if you know. So first thing is to knowing your process well, of course, and then every tasks are repetitive, and if it's very clearly task A, task B, task C, in a sequence of tasks, 30 tasks has to be done every day. I think that's the best case study or best use case for you to use RPA, and you get your best efficient. These are all, so there's a lot of use cases. Automation is possible everywhere, of course. There's no place automation cannot be done. But many places, especially the HR, supply chain, IT services, BPOs, they have really done a lot of automation, and RPA has been used. So typically the evolution of RPA starts like this. One is, of course, I told you, it's a customer demand today to be more agile, especially the way things are moving, right? So the moment you want to travel, you quickly book a Uber, right? You don't wait for that. I think that's the instant world we're living in. So I think it's more about understanding the business and industry knowledge. Curiosity, today many people are curious to see how I can automate, how I can learn. So I think the curiosity, patience, analytical skills, vision, of course, a lot of companies have a very thorough vision on where do I need to go by year 2020, by year 2030, by year 2025, where I want to go. So I think that's how the journey starts of an RPA. Now, these are the typical bot types. I think when we say robotic process automation, I'm talking about bots. The word bot, of course, if little technology savvy people may know a botnet. There are good bots, bad bots. We're talking about good bots. Good bots, of course, probots are basically robots or software processes which are simple, which can help you to create some rules, repeatable things can be processed. We call probots. No bots are especially like the bots that search the internet to gather and store. So today think of a website. In fact, imagine today, there are a lot of websites today, right? You want to go and find out, compare and buy. I want to compare mobile phones. I want to buy Apple iPhone 10 or 11, whatever, and I want to see which website gives the best price. You understand? There are sites today. So what they do, they run this RPA process. They run a bot. What the bot does, it goes to all the websites and collects the data, does this data mining, and then it gives you that. So this model of this phone is available in this, so it gives you the whole data. It's just an example, but that way there are n number of use cases today. Many, a simple example, don't you feel so? Just a classic example. How many of you agree today because of the e-commerce, today is really the big boom. So don't you feel today Reliance Trends and all these traditional shops have a pressure to compare the prices online and try to make the same price. So what they do, they also using RPA. They want to see what is the product, what is offered in all the websites so on average, what is the price, the lowest whatever. So they want to have the same price because they don't want to lose to customer. So they keep changing the price every day because based on the market. You understand? So the best offer. So today go to Reliance Trends or go to Reliance Digital, so you get the same price probably what is there in the online because they don't want to lose you. You cannot say that online, they also know that what the price available on online, so they are trying to match the same price because they use a lot of RPA and they keep matching. So there's a lot of use cases where this type of bots are used. The last one, chat bots. I'm sure all of you, if you go to HDFC Bank website, how many of you seen Eva? Eva, you can go. So the moment you log into HDFC site, so there's an option called Ask Eva. Eva, EVA. EVA stands for Electronic Virtual Assistant. So if you log into, of course, there are many websites has got these chatbots. basically they are nothing but virtual agents. It's not a human. Virtual agent, it has got all the intelligence. What typical questions customers ask, it knows. And it can respond to all the queries. What? So Eva is a classic example. HDFC, Ask Eva is an example of chatbot. So virtual agents, so these are all typical types of bots. So benefits of bot or benefits of RPA, no doubt, there are enormous benefits. I told you it's not about only cost saving, it's about enabling better customer experience, better customer service. Today, every enterprise is, so they want to provide that best experience because embracing this technology, so every organization today want to embrace technology and provide the best experience today to the consumer. So that's where RPA can get in. Ensuring business operations and processes comply with regulations, allowing processes to be completed much more rapidly. I told you, example, I want to, a bank, the moment you open an account, it takes, it earlier to take 5 days, 3 days, 4 days. Now that whole cycle time is cut in 20 minutes. 20 minutes the account is up and running because of the chat, of the whole bot process which kicks in. Think of so many examples. For example, you have million invoices coming into you and every million invoices you need to process something, do certain tasks. A RPA process can just make it more efficient. Your year-end process, month-end process, quarter-end process. So probably all the process earlier, what used to take weeks or days or months, are today the cycle time is just cut in just maybe minutes or in some places even days. I think it's all about efficiency because that's the, so I think providing improved efficiency by digitizing and auditing process data, that's the key. So there are n number of benefits. So I told you there are n number of applications of RPA while my focus is about fintech, but in customer services, accounting, financial services, healthcare, you can see in fact, all this are the key places, especially HR, supply chain. I told you supply chain is again one of the big use case today. Many, all this logistics company, right? Because supply chain is one of the biggest challenge today, right? In fact, their automation plays a very, very important role. Today, all these delivery companies, right? They use a lot of automation because for them, the moment a shipment is booked, I think some certain tasks has to be performed. So I think all that is RPA gives you a excellent way to automate these things. So typically this is how any process mapping, so typically this is the classic example of invoice processing. So how does the processing starts, where it starts, the whole workflow. I'm sure we all know the workflow. I can talk about even it is standard ERP process, how example you raise a purchase order, right? And then based on that the goods are supplied, the supplier generates an invoice, you know, I think the whole workflow process. Or each process can be broken down into tasks, and all these tasks you can just map it back. So there are, so why I just put this as an example, because once you know, I think the first important thing is to understand your process well. What is my process? Now what are the typical standard repeated tasks, and if these tasks are nothing usual, unusual, they are very standard tasks, I told you, repetitive by nature, without not much of exceptions, then it qualifies, it's a great classic qualifier for an RPA. That's how organizations start. So again, large enterprises get into a consulting engagement. Of course, all the big four firms, consulting firms, even a lot of accounting firms, I know all the KPMGs of the world, EY's and all that. And there are a lot of firms who have started. So they have a very methodical approach. Of course, organizations internally also build their own RPA capabilities. So they start the planning exercise, development, testing, and then of course you start managing the whole process and keep improving the RPA, the whole implementation methodology. So there are n number of use cases of, so these are the general use of RPA. I told you it's all about, it emulates human action. So in fact, this robotic process, this software process, what has been created, it can just emulate. In fact, lot of these new tools even has vision. You'll be surprised. In fact, there are vision processes. It can see on the screen what is there and what to pick up, what button to press, you know. So it's purely, so there are today, of course, I'll come to the tools part, but then, so basically it can completely emulate human action, or the best word I use, mimic, right? It can mimic what you can do. It can mimic what you do normally. So conduct high volume repeated tasks. That's the key. Perform multiple tasks. See, the point is humans are humans. So people normally would like to work to 9 to 5. And then, of course, after 8 hours, you have the fatigue, of course, and you get lost. You want a break, but then this robot process doesn't need a break. It'll just run, it'll run, it'll run. That is where the efficiencies come in. Virtual system integration, automated report generation. So reports, report should be automatically generated. You just write a process, it will just do it on its own. Information validation, auditing. So RPA is used extensively also in auditing. Technical debt management and many more uses of product management, data migration, revenue forecasting. It can forecast revenue based on, of course, the past data, current data, the futuristic data. I think it's all, I'm sure, in the initial slide which I spoken about the trends, the other big trend I'm sure you all know is about big data, data science. You all have heard of this buzzwords. It's no more buzzwords, it's all reality, because based on a lot of data, these systems can predict and it can do a lot of wonders for the organizations. So very, very large enterprises, differently, they have different challenges. So there are, let's talk about tools. Most of the RPA discussions are around tools, but I did not want it to make it only about tools, but then yes, these are the three big names. While in every industry, every category, you'll find many, many players. Of course, you think of any category, example, ERP, I told you, right? It's not only about SAP. There are many ERP solutions. Of course, what fits your budget pocket and what fits your requirements. People pick up Tally is great, but then Tally is good for small enterprise. Probably not for a very, very large enterprise where there's a different challenges, especially that's where people go for SAP or Microsoft Dynamics, Exapta, Navision. So different use cases, different customers. Same way, so these are the three big names. Like in ERP, we pick up SAP, Oracle, or example banking, we pick up Finacle, FlexCube, something similar in RPA. These are the three big names. Automation Anywhere, very popular name. The name itself says Blue Prism and UiPath. These are the three automation tools. All these three tools has got their own. I will spend some time at the end if time permits. I'll show you UiPath. I'll show you the website, and UiPath is again. I'm not endorsing, but then it's a great. It's a product. Lot of information available. It's a community. There's a free community version edition. You can go download and also start using it. I'll talk about that. Lot of training material available in UiPath website. I'll just show it to you at the end. You can just go and there's a lot of free learning. There's a community version available. Of course, even Automation Anywhere also gives you, but then UiPath has got, basically it's like any other tool, right? So like for your Excel, you're using for spreadsheet, similar way, these are the tools which are used for your RPA. So all these tools are very known. Blue Prism is very popular for large enterprises. I'm not saying UiPath is not, but then UiPath and Automation Anywhere also, these three are very, very popular names. So again, the same thing, I'm just expanding the discussion, the Blue Prism, Automation Anywhere, and UiPath. Of course, you can go back and do some more Googling if you want to know more about these tools. So now, we've spoken about the RPA, the robotic process automation, how they are used today by banks, by finance professionals, industries, in automating their mundane tasks. But along with RPA, also comes handy today is AI, because there's a lot of data. So artificial intelligence is all about what? You have data. I think I'm sure you heard of when we say AI. AI is completely based on your data and machine learning. So machine learns. So machine, I told you, just example, the bank systems knows your spending pattern because you are a customer. So because they know how a customer behaves, they know what this customer, who is a high net worth individual customer, who is the transaction, what is the pattern. So it's all data-based. The machine learns based on your data only, right? So today, I think Google knows you, right? Google knows where you are. Does Google knows you? Yes or no? Google knows that you all are here in a room, right? So I think probably in some time, or if you are sitting here whole day, right, Google may suggest you, right, restaurant near you, coffee shop near you, because it knows, right, you're sitting so long, it's time for you to have a coffee, right? It's time for you to go and have a quick bite, because that's again data. And I think today we all use Google Maps. We use so extensively because it predicts you which path is traffic, which path. It's all data. AI is the heart of today all these systems. So RPA is now being extended by, one is automation. I've been talking till now about automation. Now let me spend a little time on intelligent automation. That's what people are talking about. So people have already spent time on automation. In fact, many organizations have already embarked into the journey, started getting benefits, no doubt. They have been successful in automating these repetitive tasks. Now they say, how can RPA help me to do little more intelligent? Because can I increase my sales? Can I increase my value? Can I increase stakeholder value? That's where today intelligent automation is. So example, in each of these, I already told you, fraud detection is purely today intelligence based. The systems are so intelligent. It understands, is it a fraudulent transaction? It's not a fraudulent transaction. Because of the data points, I told you there are around 140 data parameters are sent to the backend. Imagine you're doing a transition from mobile device. The bank systems or the Visa card network knows this transition is coming from which country, which city, which geography, which place, which OS are you using, and which device. Is it Android, iOS? Is your device compromised? Imagine you may not know if your mobile phone is compromised and a transition is being generated. The target systems knows this looks to be a fraudulent transition. You are not fraud, but then because your system was compromised, you understand? So that level of intelligence is what is the expectation now, because naturally expectations are always to move to the next level. So automation is now done. Honestly, all of the banks, financial accounting, all those organizations have started reaping benefits. But now they say, can I use AI? Can I use this machine learning models, algorithms, because there's so much data available? And can my system predict, is it fraud, is it legitimate? As I told you, there are n number of use cases today. Example, in an ERP system, SAP system, the SAP system also can probably predict that this transaction, right? Example, a transaction which was generated by someone, authorized by someone, right, and just about to make the payment. Now the system can predict by this AI ML that is this a fraudulent transaction or is it a genuine transaction? You understand? Because of the data, the pattern, that's the whole. I think I'm sure you all have know that whenever we say artificial intelligence, it's all based on data, based on predictions, and prediction is all based on data churning, data science. So data science, so that's why today data science is also one of the big buzzwords. It's a emerging technology today. Every organization has data scientists. Who are data scientists? They know how to use data, model data, and of course data modeling is used in every place. Even a doctor today, right? Doctor knows today, because based on your past history of your health record, based on your data, the doctor or the system can predict. You understand? So I think data is everything today. I'm sure that's why today Google, Amazon, Facebook are the richest ones, because data is the new oil. And using this data, so do you agree, all of you, all these banks, these large enterprise are sitting on huge data? Yes, they're sitting on huge data. Now they want to encash, or they want to utilize this data was never used. This data is sitting on the databases as if some transactional data. Now this data, by this lot of AI ML models today, that's what is data science. By this whole data, if I can churn this data, get insights, get predictions. So today, I don't know, take names. I know NBFC, a very large NBFC, you all know, it's not only about CIBIL score, but then there are 100 parameters through which this NBFC knows which customer loan can turn NPA. You understand? Because they know. They know this because it's all data. It's not about, it's all data science. It's all data science. Because they know the pattern, they know the customer behavior. So today, a lot of this data is there, but then this data is being used by these models. There are a lot of machine learning models today, and machines are helping to churn data very methodical way and very near accurate models. So by using AI, AI plus RPA is your next level of, I call it as intelligent automation in fraud detection. See, faster claim settlement process, claim forecasting, early damage prediction. You should not wait for the damage to happen. Damage may happen. I'm sure you all know all these big guys, the big financial industries, your Fidelities, Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, all these big guys will do a lot of financial modeling. So they know what can go wrong, when is the next recession cycle, what is going to happen. Lot of data, it's all data, data and data. So early damage prediction, use of physical robots, AI enabled chatbot. Your typical example I told you is your all, every bank websites has got this intelligent chatbots coming in saying, can I help you? And they're very intelligent. They're all AI enabled chatbot. They know when is last time you had a problem, what was the resolution given, because it has got data. Sales and marketing, lot of sales and marketing predictions can happen by using this RPA and intelligent automation. And of course, I told you, AI based RPA is the next big thing happening in this industry. So I will not get into too much details. So this is just about how intelligent robotic process automation is really making a big change in the industry. So it's all about interactions, it's all about executions, and it's all about how do I optimize, because there's a lot of data. And please understand, this deep learning is all about self-learning capabilities. These bots can learn automatically, self-learning with dynamic adaptability based on the past history. It can interact with you, it can perform tasks, and can also do, it can optimize your processes to take it to the next level. So this is just a classic example. Account reconciliation is one classic example, right? Where many large enterprises have used RPA to automate. This is a very fundamental process which typically you spend a lot of time, and RPA can just do wonders. And of course, I don't want name, but very large enterprise, think of Coke, think of big Unilever, Hindustan Lever, all these enterprises have really taken RPA journey to the next level, and they've got enormous benefits because people don't want to do the same task again and again. People don't want to work, because none of us will be happy to do the same task again and again. That's where RPA can come handy. So while I spoken about RPA, great, but then let me just talk the other side of the story, RPA risks. So that's the last part. I also want to talk about, while RPA is great, but any good thing, if it's not controlled properly, if it's not governed properly, not understood properly, not programmed correctly, there will be risks, yes or no? So again, there's also, because we are, it's a part of the audit fraternity or the risk community. Again, we all have a lot of jobs. Again, we can, so I can say that even RPA based risk, in fact, risk assessments on RPAs is also one big, all the big four audit firms or many firms do, because RPA is on the rise, no doubt. Many companies have taken RPA journey, but now they also want to know what are the risks in RPA. And I'm sure I don't want to explain risk management, but then of course for every risk there are mitigating controls. That's what we all are as a control professionals. So there's a huge plethora of need for us to go and do audits on these systems, because RPA, there are risks. While we've spoken about benefits, but there are risks towards RPA. So RPA risks and controls. So again, at the top, naturally, organizations, not only I told you, then I think most of the time people talk cost, but I not seen so many organizations. One is, it's not only cost control, it's also about improving productivity. So efficiency, I think at the organization level, if they are not achieving these benefits, then it's a big risk, yes or no, right? The amount of money you spend, if it does not justify you, if you are unable to cut cost, unable to improve productivity, or unable to improve efficiencies, then your RPA journey is at risk. So again, so in like any other journey, I'm sure 10 years back, organizations who invested heavily on SAP, ERP, because I come from that domain, so many organizations burned fingers, went in, picked up wrong ERP, did not implement properly, did not do change management properly, people were not ready to accept ERP. ERP failed, yes or no? It's a big risk. Of course, for every risk you need to have. So RPA is also one great journey, but then you need to constantly see what are the risks, of course, and then implement right set of controls to ensure that these risks are mitigated, or of course, risks are inevitable. I'm sure we all are risk professionals, control professionals, we understand. But then having said that, so any emerging technology, while whenever you talk of, say example, people normally, when I go and talk, people say mobile payments, very risky. Of course, it depends. You know, you can say internet itself is a big risk, but then how far, how long can you stay away from internet, right? Because the benefits what internet gets you. Now, are you all happy to go to the branch and get your bank balance? You don't, you just log into your home, you order a checkbook. So I think the benefits and risks are two sides of the story, while most of the cases benefits overweigh the risks. That's what the RPA also. So RPA, there are risks, but till now I've spoken about the benefits, what RPA gets you, but then there are risks to also, and organizations also take a conscious call on what are the risks towards my RPA journey. And of course they have a, so what they do, at a very methodically, they do risk assessments. So example, at the operational level, what can be, imagine your bot is not programmed correctly, right? Of course, so finally it's a bot. It's a person who is programming, right? What to do, right? Example, I told you, you do a process mapping, 10 tasks, and imagine if you have programmed incorrectly, that's where in the RPA journey, we do a lot of testing, right? Testing, and finally we make it live, because of course, otherwise, if you are, so, all these bots, right? So definitely, there will be operational challenges. Imagine a bot not performing the way it has been programmed. So it's an operational risk. Suddenly, bots not working the way it is supposed to work. It's a big operational risk. Your operations can come to standstill. So of course, it's a risk, but then there are mitigating controls. So failure to create, oversight. I'm sure you all understand. There has to be a strong governance from the top. So risk management, governance, all those are fundamentals of any journey. So financial risk, especially industries, banking, insurance, which are highly regulated. Yes or no, right? Regulations, because finally, imagine a bot misbehaves, right? And a bot misbehaves or behaves erratically and gives you wrong reports, wrong results, and based on that, imagine your organization is subject to a huge penalty. Yes or no? Possible, right? Possible, because finally you are trusting your bot. Of course, bot is not, it's running automatically. You only have programmed it to do that task, and imagine your bot is behaving, or of course, like any other technology, right? So it's again, it can be a financial risk also, especially to the industry which is highly regulated, especially your banking, insurance, and all this financial. So that's also where improper implementation of automation, always, any technology for that matter, technology not implemented correctly, there are risks. Cloud is great, but cloud, the moment we talk cloud, people talk cloud risks, because it's, cloud is not risky. Is cloud risky? No, cloud is not risky, but the way we implement cloud, the way we understand cloud, the way we're not adopted the right controls, that's where the risks are. So risk is, so you have to identify, but of course there are, I'm because my last, this is my last slide. I know if you're getting too bored, maybe I'll give a pause and maybe come back to you if any questions, but then this is my last slide, because while I've spoken about all the benefits, but it's also inevitable to talk about the risks of RPA. RPA risks is also, if you ask me, I call RPA risk itself is one big opportunity for all of us here, right, to conduct audits, yes or no? There is a huge, need for these RPA processes need to be audited and ensure that these risks are highlighted to the management so that organizations take precautionary controls. So regulatory, organizational, technology, so any changes to the IT platform, all will also have an impact on your RPA. So I think these are just a very high level. So RPA, we've spoken enough about the benefits, but then there are risks. But again, it doesn't mean that because risk is there, you cannot get into the journey, because the journey, the benefits are enormous. So in that context, organizations are today increasing their spending on RPA because the benefits are much, much higher. There are risks, but then there are mitigating controls to mitigate the risk. It's a very silent room. I know I've been talking. So now let me just pause here. I'm done with the PPT. I told you PPTs are always boring, but then I'm here. I'm open for any questions. And also maybe I can quickly, I'm here. But so I told you this is typically the UI path website. I don't know how much time we have, but then there are excellent, so this is a classic case study of how Federal Bank, you can see, moves 2x as fast with RPA. I'm not sure. Okay, so you can see RPA in banking rapidly, how they are. So this is a...
Federal Bank is a leading private sector bank. In the last 4 or 5 years, we've expanded our presence beyond Kerala to build a sizable business in this country.
So at that time, we had a regulatory requirement from RBI wherein we have to follow this UCIC, something called UCIC, Unique Customer Identification Code has to be maintained. But to group these entire lakhs of customers manually was quite impossible.
Yeah, we had a challenge where we had to have a compliance regulatory requirement met. We had a huge data to be processed, which was not humanly possible.
So there's no choice but for us to look at smarter ways of doing it. And that is how we got onto this path of automation about 3 years back, and within which we chose RPA as our go-forward tool to kind of use it within operations to make our processes much more efficient, make it scalable, make it error-free, and make it, from a cost perspective, productive for the bank.
The UiPath team also, when we contacted, they provided excellent support.
We had to merge certain customer IDs, a very large number of customer IDs, legacy database, we had to merge it. Or our calculations showed that it would take about 10 people sitting for a year to try and do this before we made it a complete exercise. But thanks to our team and thanks to the work we're doing with RPA, we were able to reduce that time drastically by 50%. We got it completed in 6 months as against a one-year project that we had envisaged. Another example, we've been implementing Bharat QR, which is the QR code at our merchants. Very proud to say that
I'm just tethering internet from my mobile, so it's a little slow, but otherwise it's a classic use case, a practical live use case of, it's not about Federal Bank, but many banks,
using RPA, what started off as a 7 minutes for a person to do it manually, we brought it down to 1 minute using RPA, and we recently crossed the 1 lakh mark of BQRs implemented, which would have been kind of infeasible or unimaginable in a manual environment.
Superior TAT, increased speed, accuracy and efficiency directly improve the service TAT to customer or client, thereby creating time for further opportunities. Reduced cost, best customer experience, lower operational risk, etc. All these points certainly will improve the overall operational efficiency and growth of the bank, which will certainly be much appreciated by the top management as well as all the stakeholders.
The roadmap, when I say, it's going to be quite bright, I would say. And linked with AI, it's going to be really great.
Where I think it will help us even more is when you combine kind of the power of artificial intelligence with the power of RPA, get them together to work, then I think our operations teams and our technology teams would have truly delivered the power of RPA.
Okay, I hope because I have many case studies. In fact, I did not want to show you an MX case study or a Bank of America case study or a Citibank, because then we may not we feel it's all global. Say, like example, like Federal Bank, or even there are much smaller banks who have got into the journey of this RPA. So this is a again, I'm not trying to I'm not talking only about UiPath, but this is one of the very leading company. There are plenty of success stories, in fact, around different categories, because our discussion was more fintech, more finance oriented. So I thought how RPA in the finance and banking industry, many, you can see the n number of case studies. And this is a great, and there's a lot of learning available. In fact, this UiPath has got an academy, which is completely free. You'll not be, it's a so a lot of training. You can see this, the plan, build, manage, run, engage, measure, and how they provide the great experience and how it works. And of course, many of you, if you are a little keen to learn, so in fact, there's an academy by, you can see this, of course, RPA Academy. And I love because this site, because you can see this, all automation, you can see this, a lot of these trainings are completely free. So what's great about UiPath Academy, learn in demand skills, you can see, most of the trainings are freely, you can see, all free courses. There's a 4 to 5 hours RPA starter training. If someone is curious to know more RPA, just get in this 4 to 5 hours. You can spend time, because one more important thing, because again, I come also from the academics, because again, because I do a lot of volunteering at ISACA, like ICI. I love to teach, coach, mentor. I also talk about upskilling, yes or no? So I think each one of us also need to upskill, reskill. I'm sure that's why you are all here. And it's good to just understand, it's not technical at all. To do RPA, you don't need any technical skills, programming skills. It's just about, it's like the way you use Excel or the way you use just drag and drop. It's something very similar. So I think adding some knowledge of RPA, of course, in 1 hour or 1.5 hour, I could just give you the kickstart. But then rest all, I thought, let me show you all these things. So please go to uipath.com/RPA/academy. And a lot of these things are available free. So all these things can be really used. So now this is what I want to show you. HDFC Bank, can you see this? Ask Eva. I'm sure many of you use. So Ask Eva, this is nothing but EVA, what I told you. It's a chat bot. It's a RPA bot. It's a smart bot. It understands how can I help you today. This is just one example. Every website today has got this kind of. So Ask Eva is also one of the chat bot. It's nothing but an RPA. And of course, there are, I'm not sure how is the time I'm doing. Otherwise, maybe let me open some questions for the audience. I hope I'm on time. Was it too boring? Any questions, please? So if there are no questions, I can predict that you all understood or you did not understand anything. Anyway. I know questions, but anyway, so feel free. This is my coordinates. So happy to answer my mail ID. You can take my mail ID and feel free to connect me over LinkedIn. If anyone is curious to learn more, happy to share my knowledge and happy to help you. So am I on time? Exit on time? Thanks, great. So I hope this was great. Again, I'm still around. No questions. Yeah. Thank you. I think one question. Yes.
You can. See, it's not that RPA means you need to invest costly tools now. So there's a community edition of UiPath.
It's free. You can download community edition and maybe just drop me online. I'll send you some. It's pretty. Means I'm not saying it's. First of all, you don't need any programming knowledge. But then, so I think the point is, in a RPA journey, the first thing is to understand your processes, and you know a process. So if you know your process well, I think first important thing is not about the tool, first about the process, right? If you can map your process very well, what are the steps, and if first of all, if that process qualifies for an RPA, yes or no, it has to qualify, first of all, because So first of all, the scale in size has to be massive, yes? Then only it makes sense, right? Especially because the point is...
It will apply, again based on the number of volume. Example, see, it's all about automation. I told you, it's like simple like Excel. But if I ask you, in Excel, do you use a lot of automation, macros?
If you use, means you're already inclined towards... How do I automate my, I think repeatedly you go to one sheet, pick up some data, go to other sheet, put that data here in this column, take this data, put in some other file, you know, these are step-by-step tasks. This can be automated using these tools. So why you need tool? Because there has to be a certain workflow, drag and drop. Of course, you can also take help. So UiPath, there's a large community. You can go and talk to the community. Talk means, of course, you can go to the community and you can put your problem statement there, and someone would have done the same thing, right? So they'll keep it that handy for you. You can download that. See, that's the power of community. You understand? So probably the point is, your use case may be a similar use case to some other CA. You understand? So probably you can go and find community. First you need to understand what is your problem statement first. And then probably you can go to community and talk to the community, and definitely there will be someone who would have done that. So there's a large community, in fact community.uipath.com, you can see here, UiPath Academy and Community Forum. My request you to please go to Community Forum and keep searching for use cases, probably something similar to you. There are n number of use cases, finance use cases, especially in US, Canada, Australia, CPA firms, they have done a lot of use cases, you can see this. So you can see this is a big forum, especially, and probably you can join this forum and probably put your problem statement saying that I want to automate this. But of course, first you need to know what is that you want to automate. Then yes, the community will help you. In fact, that's how the community is basically. Did I answer your point? Yes. But anyway, I think you first start with the learning, and I told you the academy is free. Start learning. Take some time, go to, you can see this academy is free. There are a lot of resources there. And of course, you define your problem statement, and then there is, definitely it can be achieved. But you have to start somewhere just by learning and understanding. Any more questions? I know you may have questions, but you may not want to ask me. But then offline, you can always ask me whenever you feel that you have this I'll be happy to support. So with that, thank you very much for your patience, patient learning. Post-lunch, I hope I did justice to keep you awake. And if at all I disturbed you in your sleep, sorry for that. Thank you.
Though changing times are discomforting, but I think under this discomfort, we have a lot of opportunities as suggested by the speaker. And I think we are going to race for relevance and ready for radical change, unleash the potential to the 100%. So let's give a big round of applause for today's speaker for such a wonderful presentation. I request on behalf of Bangalore branch and all of us, let's present him a memento as a token of gratitude. We are heading for the next session, but before that, let's take a small tea break so that we refresh our energies and get back after 15 minutes. We are ready for session by CA Venu Gella.